Storm clouds have blown across our remarkable land long before her tempestuous history was ever recorded in story and song. But Scotland, bonnie Scotland, has always re-emerged to shower her beauty on any and all who have eyes to see. That's why it is said here that if you truly understand Scotland, you will understand life itself. For Scotland is no less complicated and no less rich. Yes, Scotland is certainly part of Great Britain, but her proudly independent character has made her a place and a people unlike any other. The southern Scottish town of Selkirk is today the picture of tranquility. That was not the case in the past, when it was a hotbed of support for numerous uprisings against English domination. Selkirk suitors, or shoemakers, outfitted the revolutionary army of Bonnie Prince Charlie. Her tranquility now is far more becoming. The capital of Scotland, Edinburgh, is not the country's largest city, but certainly one of its most dramatic, since it sits on a series of volcanic mounds. One of the region's oldest castles was built on this commanding site in the 11th century. During the wars for independence, it became a protective fortress, and eventually, the Royal Scottish Residence. Edinburgh's Royal Mile is not one, but a succession of four streets that stretch from the Castle Rock to the gates of the Royal Palace. The marvellously restored buildings that remain recreate medieval Edinburgh beautifully. Mark Calton Hill, the portico commemorating Scots who died in the Napoleonic Wars, and the tower honouring Admiral Nelson's victory at Trafalgar. If you think of Edinburgh as a provincial place, you'd be wrong. On Prince's Street, for example, you'll discover fashionable shops to rival any in the world. Sir Walter Scott, through his dramatic novels, brought the romance of Scotland to the world in the early 18th century. Readers of Rob Roy and The Bride of Lammermoor just may want to visit his Edinburgh memorial. Careful though, there are 287 steps. Located on the Firth of Forth, which opens out to the North Sea and Scandinavia, Edinburgh has long been, and remains today, a busy international port of call. Gorse, that prickly yellow evergreen that grows wild all over Scotland, may flourish elsewhere in the world, but a Scotsman would never acknowledge the fact. Scotland's religious history is captured perfectly in this magnificent 9th century abbey. Originally a Celtic house of worship, it became over the centuries a Christian religious site for Norman and Scandinavian conquerors. During the Protestant Reformation, it, like many other Scottish churches, was no longer officially accepted as a place of worship. But now, in spite of everything, its essential spirituality prevails. Another sacred site is this St Andrew's churchyard. But the town is probably better known as home to the patron saint of golf, that humbling game, than it is for anything else. No golf course in the world is better known than the Royal and Ancient Golf Course at St Andrews. Known as the Fair City on the Tay, quiet Perth has had a deceptively violent past. John Knox, the fiery 16th century religious reformer, gave an emotional sermon here that resulted in the destruction of four Catholic monasteries. In typical Scottish understatement, the violent reformers are called the Rascal Multitude. The River Tay is known for its salmon fishing, but astonishing as it might seem, freshwater pearls are also retrieved in its frigid waters. Everyone has heard the limerick that begins, "There once was a man from Dundee." But whatever else he might be known for, he was also probably very proud of his city at the head of the Tay, that was once home to the finest fishing and whaling fleets in all of Scotland. The 19th century hunt for whale oil has given way to the 20th century exploration for precious North Sea crude. A very good thing for the whales. The Scottish word for destiny is scoon, so this should really be called Destiny Palace. Since the 9th century, Scottish kings were ceremonially enthroned here on the Stone of Destiny. Robert the Bruce, a name sacred to all Scots, was crowned here. Originally a hunting lodge, Glam's Castle has been in the same aristocratic family since 1372. King James V had the eccentric Lady Glam's burnt as a witch. The locals swear that her ladyship's ghost still wanders restlessly about the great halls. On a lovely Aberdeen weekend, many folks find it pleasant to stop at Drumcastle for a village outing. And certainly it would be wise to set some time aside for a leisurely stroll through the formal gardens. Sunday morning, of course, is reserved for church, most likely Presbyterian. And then perhaps an afternoon visit to an antique car show. After that, maybe even time for a bit of sport as well. We, however, might just decide to follow the River Dee to its sources, all the way up the mountainous area known as the Cairngorms, up into the very heart of the Highlands. This is the heart of Scottish romance. Here is where many of our clans dwell, where you can see their tartans, and where you hear echoes of the old Celtic language, and perhaps even the wistful sound of distant bagpipes. Here, we can be touched by Robert Burns' lament, by the words that touch all Scots men and women separated from the land they love. My heart's in the Highlands, my heart is not here. My heart's in the Highlands, a-chasing the deer. A-chasing the wild deer and following the roe. My heart's in the Highlands, wherever I go. Yes, our hearts are in the Highlands, and the Highlands are forever in our hearts. So we have preserved their beauty as well as their precious wildlife in a series of national wilderness parks. For if we Scots do not preserve our own great natural legacy, who will? the serenity of a beautiful summer's day in a typical Loch Tay village really belies the difficult isolation many country folk face in a Highland winter. The northernmost islands of Scotland, after all, extend almost to the Arctic Circle. So summer days like this one, even here in the Highlands, are times to be treasured. Beyond every Highland range lies yet another glacial lake, or loch, each one more beautiful than the last. One Highland loch, however, is known throughout the world not merely for its beauty, but for a monstrous resident who may, or may not, actually dwell in its dark waters. Visitors usually climb the 50 steps up to the castle's ramparts to gaze into the loch, hoping to see Nessie, the monster. They often see what they want to see. The largest lakes of the Highlands are long and narrow because they lie on the Great Glen fault line that cuts across Scotland. The Caledonian Canal was built 200 years ago along the same line to link the lakes and create a continuous waterway that connects Scotland's east and west coasts. Known as the Hub of the Highlands, Inverness is strategically located near Loch Ness, near the eastern or North Sea coast. Historically, it has been the scene of almost continual warfare and strife. As a result, there are few historic buildings left in Inverness. Canals are, in fact, a superb and very civilized way to experience the Great Glen of the Western Highlands. There are very few places in the world where boaters can find such personalized service. Because of the country's long, rugged coastline, its hundreds of offshore islands, and large glacial lakes, the Scots have been magnificent sailors ever since men have taken to the sea. Nothing can beat the taste of wild Scottish salmon. But salmon farming has become a far easier way to earn a living from these waters. Mm-hmm. west coast Firth of Lorne is one of the most treacherous waterways in the world, which is why sailors are grateful for the beacons that guide them safely back home. Guarding the Sound of Mull, Duart Castle, home to the chieftains of the Clan MacLean, was first built on this rocky crag in the 13th century. If there is a town that is the West Coast equivalent of Inverness, then it is Oban, whose North Channel harbour is a haven for fishing fleets, ferry boats and tourist ships. This is not a Roman Colosseum, merely a replica of one, built to relieve severe unemployment in Oban at the end of the 19th century. It is also a memorial to the thoughtful and generous banker who commissioned it. The formal garden here is really the least part of this 50-acre setting. the magnificent arboretum, as well as the winding paths and waterfalls, have made Crary a rare forest garden overlooking Loch Fyne. The delightful whitewashed town of Inverary is the ancient seat of the Clan Campbell, whose rivalry with the MacDonald clan led to the infamous massacre at Glencoe. Each of the 10 bells in the tower is named after a Celtic saint. Saint Mund, patron saint of the Campbell clan, is bell number 3. The Inverary jail is not worthy of a whitewash. It's a shame it occupies so prominent a place on the shorefront. When the Clan Campbell acquired the lands of Clan MacDougall in the 14th century, they also had feuded for as long as anyone could remember, they built this castle here in Inverary as a symbol of their newly acquired authority. For this is a land in which ancient triumphs and tragedies echo still over these historic fields, behind these rock walls, and high above these stony monuments to the past. Fresh waters from many sources rush down from the Trossach Hills through the woodlands below and run eventually into the Queen of Scottish Lakes, the 23-mile-long Loch Lomond, so celebrated in sonnet and song. The Trossachs are a fairly rugged range, although not very lofty. We Scots see them as an idyllic landscape for our irrepressible passion for taking very long walks in the mountains. All the ghosts of Scotland's glories and tragedies seem to have passed through historic old Stirling. The memory of Sir William Wallace, the hero of the Battle of Stirling Bridge, our original Braveheart, is honoured by this beloved and revered national monument. Historic Stirling Castle sits on a high crag and dominates the countryside. It was one of Scotland's most impregnable fortresses, a stronghold for royalty for as long as there have been Scottish kings and queens. This circle marks Robert the Bruce's ancient command post before the fateful Battle of Bannockburn, where an English army was routed by a much smaller Scottish force. The patriotic pride engendered here is forever captured in these lines of Robert Burns, known by heart to every Scotsman. Scots wha hae wi Wallace bled, Scots whom Bruce has aften led, welcome to your gory bed, or to victory. Nothing annoys us more than the fact that some people refer incorrectly to the Scottish as the Scotch. There is only one true meaning for Scotch, and it is here, aging in wooden casks. In the Great Central Valley, tourists are invited by guidebooks to follow the Whisky Trail, which runs about 70 miles and will take visitors to more than 50 distilleries. The joke along the trail is Rome was built on seven hills, but Scotland's built on seven stills. The charming town of Doon was renowned in the 17th century for its gunsmiths. The famous Highland pistol was manufactured here. Now it is best known for its castle. Built in the late 14th century, the gatehouse of the castle is nearly 100 feet tall, a remarkable architectural feat at the time. Tintern Rock was once the capital of the independent Kingdom of Strathclyde. Now it is just the scenic approach to the Glasgow region, known familiarly as the Dear Green Place. Although there is a dynamic cultural and arts scene here, the real business of Glasgow, by far Scotland's most populous city, is business. The heart of Glasgow is George Square, with its many ornate 19th century governmental buildings. Even more elaborate is Glasgow's Royal Infirmary. So imposing, it almost dwarfs one of the city's oldest and most revered buildings, the 13th century Gothic Glasgow Cathedral. On a summer Sunday afternoon, band music accompanies Glaswegians strolling on the city green as they make their way to the glass house, which is part of the People's Palace. There are four major soccer teams in Glasgow. This is the home of the 1st Division Glasgow Rangers. When Celtic plays Rangers, nothing else in Glasgow matters very much. Glasgow University was founded in 1451. The very first classes were held in the cathedral. Since then, the university has become one of the finest academic institutions in the British Isles. Modern Glasgow has established itself along the Clyde waterfront with visionary buildings one would never expect. Locals enjoy calling this one the Armadillo. As in all great cities, there is always a rush to beat the traffic home to the suburbs, especially on a Friday afternoon. But the green, virgin hills of the Central Valley are only minutes beyond most suburban towns. Not all historic sites capture the nobility of the past. Some places are harsh reminders of the inevitable ravages of time. This bright, legendary land, our welcoming Scotland, has taken us over her stunning waterways. She has willingly offered us her lowlands and her forested, gorse-covered, craggy heights. As well as her highlands, renowned the world over in legend, in the romantic tales of Sir Walter Scott, and in the lyrical poems of Robert Burns. Thank you. so we have indeed taken the cup of her kindness yet. And now is a good time to toast her proud character and her unique natural beauty for auld lang syne.